On August 21st, 1965, the Beatles landed in the Twin Cities.
I can tell people their stories, and I know they think I'm lying.
Ray Crump has, beneath the jockstraps of the 65 Minnesota Twins, the proof.
I didn't know who they were, I'll be truthful with you. And if I said I did, I'd be a liar.
Ray was the Twins equipment manager who spent 8 hours preceding Metropolitan Stadium's most famous concert in the home clubhouse with four British visitors.
They asked me this question, where's Killebrew's locker room? That's all they knew was Killebrew. They have never taken a sauna in their lives. They've never seen a sauna. So do you want to go in the sauna? They said, yes, we want to go in the sauna. So they went into the sauna.
That very day, a 12-year-old girl and a 13-year-old boy would have given anything to be Ray.
Some 3,000 screaming teenagers greeted the Beatles when they landed at Minneapolis-St. Paul International Airport.
Helene and Jimmy Pessis both had tickets for the date.
It was August 21st.
Though they wouldn't date each other for three more years.
Here's the proof that Paul was Helene's favorite. She drew a heart with an arrow to Paul. I don't remember any pictures of me like that with a with a heart and an arrow.
50 years.
Well, I remember the intensity of just the Beatles themselves. I mean, first of all, they were adorable, and it was the first boy band.
All of which was lost on Ray.
See, each Beatle would take a picture of me with the other Beatles. This is Ringo Starr and I. George Harrison spent 8 hours playing the guitar. Then you got Paul McCartney. And people tell me, how many people have been in the bed with John Lennon? Get up as close as I could get.
Ray was just off the platform.
And I took these pictures.
When the Beatles were asked at their pre-concert press conference if it was hard to sleep with all that hair.
Well, when you sleep, you don't notice.
One reporter described them as cocky.
How do you sleep with your arms and your legs still attached? Just the same.
But their target audience ate it up.
After 8:30 p.m., all heaven broke loose. That's funny. When Ringo Starr, George Harrison, Paul McCartney, and John Lennon came out of the Twins' dugout and strolled toward the stage that was set up over second base.
30,000 fans erupted, one of which held up a tape recorder, gathering the Met Stadium concert's only known audio.
They're tuning up.
A treasure for collectors like Rick Anderson.
The first song, it's Paul singing She's a Woman.
You could hardly see them, and there wasn't a sound system like there is now. So, you know, you just kind of knew you were there, and you were part of the experience.
We'd like to do a slow song now, especially for that airplane. And you can hear the roar going over.
The 150 or so ushers, armed with smelling salts, braced themselves. People did faint.
I still have the plates and cups that they ate on.
But Ray Crump also paid a price for having been seen with Ringo Starr's arm around his shoulder.
And this girl comes up and she rips my shirt right off of me. She ripped it, just tore it apart because he touched that shirt.
The rest is legend.
This is pretty risque.
A curfew enforced, girls chased from hotel rooms, and an infamous statement from Minneapolis police.
One of their group with a British accent told me that they would never come back to Minneapolis, and I remarked to him that if they did not come, it would be too soon for me.
And they never did.
That was the last trip to Minneapolis in 65, and then they quit touring in 1966. And never really played live again.
Does it seem like 50 years?
No. 50 years is going fast.
No, doesn't seem like 50 years. No, where has time gone?
Seems like yesterday.
It was the biggest thing there was.